Every day, every month, every season is a journey. This is the story of a journey started years ago by the many that have gone before. Champions.
Lightning has just struck twice.
All MEAC selections and all Americans. Now the baton has been picked up by a new breed of Eagles. And this is their legacy.
Well, I think the biggest thing we wanted to do was leave our tradition and leave our legacy. It's what we talked about the entire 2016 of January when the season began, all the way throughout the entire year. We wanted to make sure that we left a tradition and we left a legacy here at North Carolina Central. We knew we had a senior quarterback. We had some great offensive linemen that were seniors. Defensively, we knew we had some guys coming back that played a big role in our success over the last 2 years. So the biggest thing that we tried to do was just make sure that everybody was on the same accord and the same agenda.
You get your first game at Duke, regular team, and you don't get the best start of the season in that game. Just go back and what do you remember from that game going into it?
Well, the first half was a debacle. You know, we didn't perform very well. Our effort, our energy, nothing about that first half was a reflection of what I knew we could be. The second half, we held them to 0 points. So I could tell that if we played the second half of that Duke game like we played the rest of the season, we were going to have a really good chance to have a good football team.
And then the second game of the season, what's a much easier? You go to Western Michigan. And a lot of points scored in that game. A lot of points scored by North Carolina Central. You scored the most points ever against a FBS opponent in that game. But talk about that game as well. You go into that game coming off the back of the Duke game.
Well, what I liked about that game, you saw a football team get better. From an offensive standpoint, we did some really good things. Like you said, we scored the most points ever against an FBS opponent and also had a touchdown call back. I saw the defense. They went out there and they were competitive and they competed against a very, very good Western Michigan football team. So I saw us as a team grow an entire lot in that game, and you could see our team growing and getting better.
So football is a game everybody likes to win. First two games you come up with that one. And what was the morale of the team like after those first 2 weeks of the season? What'd you have to say to them?
We talked about just as a football team, you know, we got those guaranteed games out of the way. And now the focus now was to go 9-0. Pretty much we wanted to make sure that we didn't lose another game the entire season. We knew that the competition level was going to start to balance out some. We're going to start facing opponents that a lot of those people we had beat in the past and that we had success over. So I think our confidence level was still high. We still knew we had a good football team, even though we came off those two losses, because we saw our football team get better from week one to week two. So going to that third week against the St. Aug, we knew we had to put a great product on the field. They're going to hand it off to the fullback walking into the end zone as the Eagle sideline explodes. Who else but Carl Jones? Central. Malcolm Bell. Hello.
I think they're fired up. I think as a team, as an entire team, we're fired up just to go down there and have a chance to battle one of the co-champs in the conference. I think it's a great test to see kind of where we are again. And, you know, this year as a football program, as a football team. Bethune has always been a challenging game for our program. You know, last year it came down to the wire, and you know, it's probably going to be a similar situation this year.
You play with high energy, you go out there and hit them in the mouth. Take the fight to them. You the champs, it's time to show it tonight. Break it down, let's go, Endo. Championship on three, championship on three. 1, 2, 3.
Fires this one down the far sideline after it, hauling it in to the 35, to the 20. David Miller. We have now entered a lightning delay.
You know, it was tough. You know, we were in a situation where we couldn't go anywhere. You know, our guys were hungry. It was about, I think it was a 2-3 hour weather delay, and we just kind of sat around. But one of the things that was so impressive is our senior group, our seniors, they did not let the team get down. I mean, when we, every time we came out, every time we was about to come out, our energy levels was extremely high. When we finally got a chance to step back on the field, you could just tell you had a group of 60, 70 guys, they were ready to go out there and compete. And that's what they did that time, that second half when they got a chance to go out. Talking about playing in a hurricane, the worst conditions that I've ever played in, I think a lot of our guys have ever played in, was that game. You know, it seemed like one of those games where nothing could really go right. Even we take 2 steps forward, we take 4 steps back. And then we finally figured out a way to put a drive together at the end of the game. I think Darrell McClain, that last drive, he showed why he was a preseason all-conference selection. He did a great job of pushing us down the field and basically propelling us, helping propel us to a win.
Awesome McClain. McClain, big cut up the field to the 20, 15, 10, 5, race to the end zone. He cuts inside. Oh my goodness, Darrell McClain. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Mike Jones watches bounce. He's going to take it into the 40. Takes away from two now. But as a reverse field, he does. Trying to get to the sideline, gets to the middle of the field. Gets to the 30, has a blocker. 20, 15, 10, 5. Hello, Mike Jones.
Who?
Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Who's that man?
Mike Jones.
Who?
Mike Jones.
Man alive. Into Ramadan's hands. Passes over the middle. Caught by Wilkes. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. He'll take a knee, and he'll probably take that game ball with him back to Durham. 5-0 in conference play. Here's the punt high into the air. Jones shields his eyes, brings it in at the 10. Looking for his blockers, goes right up the gut, gets to the 30, gets to the second level, 50-yard line, to the 40. Hustling towards the near sideline, 30, 20, 15, 10, 5. Who's that man? Mike Jones. Touchdown on the 90-yard punt return. Take it up the field in the draw. Gets through the tacklers to the 30, 20, 15, 10, 5. Put him on the board. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Game time.
Yeah, they bailed out and went cover zero and didn't protect the middle of the field. And when he stepped up, it was like taking candy away from the baby.
North Carolina Central takes down Howard 30-21. The number 25 ranked Eagles. Get ready for the top 10 North Carolina A&T State Aggies next Saturday here in Durham, North Carolina.
For North Carolina Central to be nationally ranked, were you somebody that kind of look on Mondays and see where the polls were, and you saw North Carolina Central kept climbing all season long, and what was your reaction when you see the Eagles start to get the break.
I was excited for our program more than anything. You know, you talk about a program that had not been an FCS program very long, and to be nationally ranked, that just says that we were starting to gain some respect, not only in the media, but also from other coaches. They are starting to see the body of work that we were putting forth and we were putting out there week to week. And then from your peers, they start to see that, and it just makes you feel good as coaches. It makes you feel good as a player as well, because now you know people know that you're a force to be reckoned with. You had beat A&T, they had been ranked the last couple of years, and you had beat them, and now you're going in, you're starting to develop a certain type of stature, a certain type of reputation for yourself. And that's what I was most proud of, was our team and our program.
Keep this spotless record all the way up from North Carolina A&T. They come in, nationally televised game, and North Carolina Central nationally ranked for the first time at the FCS level.
Well, you know, that's one of those games you throw the records out the window. When we get a chance to face North Carolina A&T, that's a big rivalry for us. You know, nothing, everything's off the table. Coaches are spending a little extra time in the film room. Players are spending a little extra time in the film room. We're on the practice field a little bit longer just to make sure we wrap up all the finer details of what we need to do. So you know when A&T comes to town, you know, they're going to be in for a dogfight. And I think that's one of the things that has helped us throughout the last 3 years. You know, we have a sense of we're not going to, or we refuse to, lose to our counterparts or our rival. And we put our foot in the ground, and we make sure that everything possible that it takes to win that football game, we're going to try to do. That means up front, we're blocking a little bit longer, a little bit harder. Our receivers are playing a little bit faster. Our quarterback is doing some really good things. Our safeties, our corners, everybody understands how important that is. That goes all the way from the starter, first team starter, all the way to the guy that never plays. He understands, everybody in our organization understands how important it is that week to put everything forward to give ourselves a chance to be successful on that Saturday.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, let's give our senior football players and team managers a huge Eagle round of applause. Thank you ever so much for choosing NCCU.
Eagle football is on the air. Welcome to O'Kelly Riddick Stadium for the showdown. And North Carolina Central takes on the Aggies of North Carolina A&T State University right here on the NCCU Sports Network. North Carolina Central 8-2, 7-0 in conference, ranked number 20 in the nation. North Carolina A&T 9-1, also 7-0 in conference, ranked number 9 in the nation. The Eagles and the Aggies right here on the NCCU Sports Network. Glad to have you with us. So the Eagles will receive to start this game. They will go from left to right on your radio dial here in the first half of play. Everybody is set. The ball is in the air.
Oh, yeah.
To the five,
oh, yeah.
And he's into the end zone. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Eagles strike first.
Yeah, excellent job that time we came out in the trips. They stayed in cover two. And because of that, they were able to get something going.
Bell gets this one. Oh, he's going to keep it. Gets to the 30-yard line, 35-20. Racing 10. Five gets to the corner. Dives for the pylon. Give it to him. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Touchdown on the 30-yard carry. It is now 13-0 with the extra point pending. Breaking, 15, 10,
oh, yeah.
5, dies,
oh, yeah,
for the end zone. Give it to him. Put him on the board. Second of the day. Malcolm Bell, my house. 5:51 to go in the third quarter. 27-7, North Carolina Central wins. Eagle fans, making some noise. Romero looking upfield, rushed, and he is going to get the sack that you were calling for. Who is it? Freddie Henry Ajuda.
Oh, yeah, I like how this kid is playing. He's playing like it's his last home game ever.
Pressure, they bring seven. Bell goes a one-on-one to Stinson. He leaps, has it with one hand.
Woo!
Kidding me?
Are you kidding me? Make Odell Beckham jealous.
Khalil Stinson, touchdown on the one-hand reception. Tight walking the far sideline.
Wow, what a play.
That's one of those plays all you can say is what?
Oh, my goodness. All he could do was stick one arm up and he was able to pull it in.
At what point did you realize that the Eagles were starting to pull away and that you had the championship?
Well, I think the last run by Darrell McClain on the 78-yard touchdown, because I think they scored on the series before that. And then for us to counter and come back and score on a 70-yard touchdown, probably our longest run from scrimmage of the entire year, that just showed that no matter what happened that day, we were going to find a way to win that football game.
McClain takes a big cut, and there's nobody there. 40, 50, 40, 35, 30, foot race, 20, 15, 10, 5. McClain dies for the pylon, and touchdown! Woo, buddy, Darrell McClain!
Hey, why take 10 when you can do it in one?
76 yards on the carry, Darrell McClain, touchdown!
Wow.
They're going to wind the clock, and that's going to do it. For the third year in a row, it's a maroon and gray victory. Perfect for North Carolina Central through the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference. 8-0, the Eagles take down North Carolina A&T. The final score, Eagles 42, Aggies 21. We will see you in Georgia for the Celebration Bowl.
We were just extremely excited. I was so proud of our seniors and just our entire team and our coaching staff, because what they accomplished on that day, no other program, no other team at North Carolina Central at the FCS level had been able to accomplish. So, you know, we talk about your tradition, you talk about your legacy, but we felt like the 2016 team, hopefully in 10 years or whatever the amount may be, will be able to come back and be recognized as one of the best teams to ever play in North Carolina Central history.
So you go and you get the invitation to the Celebration Bowl, and I know you probably felt like you should have been there the year before. Did it feel like you were vindicated a little bit just to be able to go out and represent the MEAC this year?
We were extremely excited. You know, everything about the Celebration Bowl and what it stood for and standpoint from getting a chance to play on the national stage and showcase what we have been doing the entire year or the body of work that we had put together in the last 3 years. I think our program was exciting, and it was great for our school as well to have an opportunity to have a branding situation where we could get out there to the nation and show what North Carolina Central had to offer.
So after you beat North Carolina A&T, you finish 9-0 for the rest of the season, and you have 3 weeks to reset and prepare for the Celebration Bowl, but you have to wait a week to find out who you're going to play, and then you see that it's scrambling. What did you think when you saw that they were going to be the SWAT champ?
Well, we knew that was going to be a tough opponent. You know, we had a really good feeling that Grambling was going to find their way into that Celebration Bowl some kind of way. They had dynamic players across the field. But we were excited to get a chance to play another nationally ranked opponent. You know, if you want to be the best, you got to play the best, and that's how I felt. And we got a chance to play probably a really, really good team, a nationally ranked team, obviously. And, you know, we knew we had our hands full.
What was the experience like arriving in Atlanta?
I think everybody was just extremely impressed, not only from our coaching staff, also we took some administrators as well. Just the class of the event and of what the Celebration Bowl put on. Our players getting a chance to go in the gift room suite, stay in five-star hotels, and also to being treated pretty much like royalty. And that's what the college experience is all about. You know, you get a chance to live out your hopes and dreams. You put all the hard work in from January all through November, and then, bam, in December, you get a chance to go participate in the bowl game.
It feels amazing, man. It's a new experience for us. First bowl experience, so it's just a blessing to take it all in.
That's an honor to be here, man. I never thought we'd get to this moment, but hard work and dedication to get us here.
Amazing, man. Feel good that we're here. We got a great opportunity to be here, man. I'm just I'm just thankful for this moment. I'm just ready to play.
Cold. Hey, that's what I remember about that first practice, being down there in Atlanta. We got a chance to practice at Georgia State. It was very, very cold out there. But we also, you know, had a type of focus about ourselves that we still, you know, the field was still going to be 100 yards long, and we're still going to go out there and practice and do what we do.
And then during the week of preparation, you hear the unfortunate news of the passing of one of our former Eagles. I know that was tough for the team.
It was, you know, to try to explain what Ty Brown meant to our program during my year here in 2014. He helped us win that first championship, the MEAC championship. And we always say Ty was the ultimate teammate. He was just a young man that no matter what he needed to do, he was going to leave it out on the field for his brothers. And what we hope is that one day we can represent him and win it, bring home a national championship in remembrance of him.
So the team carries some extra motivation. You get to Friday and you get onto the field at the Georgia Dome. What was that practice like, just being able to get underneath the dome and playing a game, a college football game, one of the last college football games that was going to be played in that building?
It was very important. It was very important that we get a chance to run around in that venue. We had never played in a stadium that large before. We had never been in a facility like that. I think everybody's eyes were bright. Everybody was excited. But at the end of the day, we had to calm everyone down and let them know that we're still here to win a football game. But I'm so glad and so blessed we got a chance to go in that stadium and practice, because I do think it got a chance to relieve some of the nerves and get rid of some of the jitters that we had before we got a chance to go in that stadium.
Saturday morning, you get ready. It's a noon kickoff, which was the earliest kickoff that North Carolina Central had all last season. So pregame's going on. What are your thoughts during pregame?
More than anything, I'm just hoping we get everybody to the field. You know, hoping we don't have any hiccups, nobody's scared or doesn't come out the locker room, but that was not the case at all. Our guys were fired up, they were geeked up to be playing in that stadium. Everything that we had talked about, playing on national television, everything was about to happen in less than 5 minutes. And we got a chance to play on a great stage, and that was the beauty of the entire event. You know, guys worked so hard their entire careers in order to get a chance or opportunity like that.
You're gonna fly high, baby, you know that.
I'll do it for my man, Ty. Do it for my man, Ty.
I want everybody to do one thing for me right now. I want you to close your eyes. Just close your eyes. I want you to think about if you had one opportunity to go out there and play your heart off. One opportunity to go out there for one last time and do something you've been doing since you were small. One opportunity, your one-sided moment to go out there on a national stage and do something that's never been done in Division I at NCCU. Now open your eyes. That one opportunity is right now. Right now. Walking through those doors, that's what you got. You worked hard, you worked long, your entire career to say what? I can do what they do on television. Yeah. I can play for a national championship. Yeah. I can get a ring. Well, here you go. Yeah. That one chance, that one shot is what we're going to do tonight.
Yeah.
You guys understand that?
Yes, sir.
Fast, physical, and furious for four quarters. You don't look at the score. Don't look at the score. Play your game as hard and as fast as you can, win your individual battle, and stay in the moment the entire game. The stage is not too big. The setting ain't too big because we do it every day. Now let's show the world what we about. You guys understand?
Yes, sir.
North Central.
Central.
Let's pray.
On the clock, a total of 60 to play in regulation. He strides forward. Here we go in the 2016 Celebration Bowl. This kick deep into the end zone, and it's going to be returned. Breaking Woo! Through, and he is popped at the 12-yard line.
The Eagles get on the board first to get a field goal, although I know that you're probably hoping that you could have gotten 6 points on the board in that first drive.
Yeah, you know, but I think what more than anything what that showed is that we can play with these guys. We move the ball right down the field. We matriculated the ball down the field really good. We did some really good things, and that just showed that, hey, we're not out of our league or they're not out of our league. So all we have to do is just play the same style, the same brand of football that we've been playing for the entire year. And hopefully at the end of the game, we're going to have a chance to be on top.
Bell throws on the screen, caught by Jason Murphy. He gets to the 50, swiping out of tackles.
Uh-oh.
Gets to the 40, 35, 30, going to the sideline and brought down. Jason Murphy weaving, dodging traffic. How do you do?
You get to halftime, and it's a pretty low-scoring game at that point. What did you feel the Eagles did well in the half, and what did you tell the team while they were hanging in there in the first half?
Well, I thought defensively our guys came to play. They were playing just great. I mean, the way we flew around to the ball, the way we were causing turnovers and making plays on the defensive side of the ball. Coach Eastman really had those guys geeked up, and they came ready to play. Offensively, we did some good things as well. We just couldn't close the deal at the time. You know, we got the ball in the red zone a couple of times. We threw an interception one of those times, and then another time we came only able to come away with 3 points. So we showed that we could move the ball. But at the end of the day, you have to score touchdowns. And I said all week going into that game, we're not going to be grambling with field goals. They're too good of a football team to do things like that. We're going to have to try to close the deal and score touchdowns. And I knew, you know, we just wanted to stay upbeat, want to stay positive, because we weren't playing bad. We just needed to do some better things on the offense side as far as closing the deal. So I really felt good coming out the half about what our chances were going to be the remainder of the game.
Third quarter, there were only two touchdowns scored in the game. Grambling got the first one on the run from Martez Cameron. What did you tell the team after that score went on the board just to help keep them motivated, keep them focused?
We were fine. You know, we realized that, hey, we didn't fit a certain run up, and a really explosive player, a really good player, took advantage of that situation. That's what you're supposed to do in those types of situations. But we weren't down by no stretch of the imagination. We were excited to try to get the ball back in the offensive hands, and hopefully that gave them the sense of urgency and the surge they needed to be able to try to put one in the end zone as well.
Kelly is the tailback. Going to give to Kelly. He is stonewalled.
He didn't get it.
And he might have gotten enough for the first down. But I don't think he did.
They can't give him that on that push. They blew it dead at the point.
The Eagles are fired up. They got to get the ball out of there.
I don't think he got it. He's a yard short at least.
What are they talking about, man? That's what we do. That's what we do.
Well, I think somebody on offense wanted to make a play. I don't think we had a situation where anybody was sitting around waiting for someone else to sit there and make a play. Everybody on offense wanted to be the guy. And that's when you know you got something special. When receivers are asking for the ball, running backs are asking for the ball, quarterback is asking to put the ball in his hands and let him put it on his shoulders, and offensive line is saying, hey, we got it. No, we got it, coach, no matter what you do. And I think that was what was special more than anything about this group. Nobody was afraid and nobody was scared to be a difference maker and a playmaker. And, you know, we tried to get the ball to a multitude of guys. It just didn't kind of come out that way.
Bell gets the snap. Looking. Goes on the double move. He's going to take it down. He's going to run with it towards the near side. No, he's going to throw. Quentin Atkinson open. Catches. Put your hands up. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Touchdown, North Carolina Central. Touchdown, North Carolina Central.
And then you finally do get the big play to break on this Malcolm Bell hit. Quentin Atkinson in the back of the end zone. For Quentin, after he missed most of last year, getting that big touchdown, I know it was probably a big weight off of his shoulders.
It was. You know, he had a couple of good catches in the game, and obviously he closed the game and made that big catch for us with a few minutes left in the game. Unfortunately, we just could not convert on the extra point situation. And that's nobody's fault. That's more than anything, it's probably my fault. We got to do a better job of going back to the drawing board and making sure we clean up those things. So if we ever get in that situation again, if we ever have an opportunity like that again, we can make sure that we bring home the trophy.
The Western Michigan game was in September. You go 3 months without a loss, and you get to the end of the season, and you lose in a heartbreaking fashion. What'd you have to tell that team in the locker room?
Well, I told them don't hang their heads about anything. More than anything, they set some history. They set a great standard for what we hope to be and what we're trying to get back to. Those seniors, they did exactly what they set out to do. They left a tradition, and they're leaving a certain type of legacy from their senior class that's going to be remembered forever. And more than anything, I want to talk to the team, that 2017 team that was in their locker room, about, you know, if they remember, they pulled that stage out, they threw that confetti out, and they rushed us off the field. And the goal going into 2017, we're not going to be the team that's rushed off this year. We want to bring home that national championship trophy.
I'm proud, and you should be proud of what you accomplished. For you seniors, you did a hell of a job. Don't let your entire career be based off one game, okay? You played 30, 40 games since you've been here. Don't let your career be marked off one. Be proud of what you've accomplished. For you underclassmen coming back, I hope you see how good you really can be. We came this close to knocking out the second team this year that's ranked number one. That's how close you were. But just let it be a reminder, all right? The celebration is going on out there. You hear the crowd cheering. You hear to see them pulling out the stage. You need to keep that deep inside. You need to remember that feeling that you feel right now for you underclassmen. Because that's what's going to have to motivate you to get back here next year. You guys understand? Let's pray.
So as you sit here looking back at the 2016 season, What was one big thing that you can take away from it? What were some of your best memories from that?
I think one of the best memories was being A&T on our home field on that day. To have friends, families, Eagle supporters, people that have been with us through ups and downs over the last few years, and even through the transition of becoming a Division II program to a Division I program. I think that was kind of put the icing on the cake that we've kind of arrived. And we got a great situation here. You know, we got a chance to showcase what we were able to do on national television. On ESPN was there that day. The bowl committee was there that day. Like I said, our friends, our family was there. And when they gave us that trophy, the commissioner of the league, and also too, with our chance of being on the field, and the head of the bowl committee being on the field as well, and our athletic director Ingrid Wicker McCree, that was just a special moment for everybody involved.
So now you're in spring camp for 2017. What do you see right now as you start to get ready for the next year, and how important is the spring for the fall?
Spring is very important. We're trying to figure out what our identity is going to be this upcoming season. The 2016 team was a great team. They did a lot of good things for us, but the reality of it is there is no carryover from year to year. Every year you have to really go back to the drawing board. You have to input different schemes. You have to reteach different schemes. You have to tweak different things, different people, different faces at different positions. So, you know, as much as you want to say, hey, we can build off what happened last year, the reality of it is that's not the case, because you can't. Last year was last year, so you don't know exactly what's going to be the result. You don't know who's going to all be on the field for you. So you just want to make sure that you're trying to develop a sense of toughness about our football team, and we're trying to figure out each day what are some things that are going to give us some kind of insight on what kind of team we're going to be this upcoming year.
All right, Coach, do you have any final thoughts that you'd like to add about the 2016 season?
I think the biggest thing was our tradition, our legacy prevailed. You know, over the last few years, in my first year in 14, we were all talking about teamwork makes the dream work. And then in 15, it was leave no doubt. And then in 16, it was what is your tradition going to be? What is your legacy going to be? And I think everything finally all came to fruition in 2016. You know, obviously you saw the teamwork, it made the dream work in 2016. Then you talk about leaving no doubt. I don't think we left any doubt who was a better team when we played North Carolina A&T. And then to leave a legacy of being one of the first outright MEAC champs in the last 4 years, everything kind of came together for us this year.
Every football season is a journey. A journey that some consider ends in spring. After months of joy and heartbreak, pain and triumph, after weeks of rising early and tying your shoes tight, of lining up with your brothers and going toe-to-toe to stake your claim and leave a legacy. After the summer, fall, and winter, comes the spring. But the spring is not the end. It's a continuation. A continuation of the tradition set by those who came before. A tradition of winning as a team and of leaving no doubt. Spring is not the end. Spring is a continuation of a legacy.
You're out there, Johnson. We gotta go.
Who's house?